Mr. Foreman, and gentlemen of the jury, it is the first time in my life that I speak publicly in your wonderful language, and it is the most solemn moment in my life. I know not if I will go to the end of my remarks. The district attorney and the other gentlemen here, who are used to measure all human emotions with a yardstick, may not understand the tumult that is going on in my soul in this moment. But my friends and my comrades before me, these gentlemen here, who have been with me for the last 7 or 8 months, know exactly. If my words will fail before I reach the end of this short statement to you, it will be because of the superabundance of sentiments that are flooding my heart. I speak to you not because I want to review this evidence at all. I feel that I have had, as the learned district attorney said, one of the most prominent, if not the most prominent attorney in this state, to plead for my liberty and for my life. I shall not enter into the evidence that has been offered here, as I feel that you, gentlemen of the jury, have by this time a firm and set conviction. By this time you ought to know, you ought to have realized whether I said or whether I did not say those words that have been put into my mouth by those two detectives. You ought to know whether it is possible, not for a man like me, but for any living human being to say those atrocious, those flagitious words that have been attributed to me. I say only this in regard to the evidence that has been introduced in this case. If there is or ever has been murder in the heart of any man that is in this courtroom today, gentlemen of the jury, that man is not sitting in this cage.
That was about 2 minutes of almost an hour-long performance that is really riveting, and we actually had a very intimate version of it here on the 12th because we were supposed to do it at the Borough of Manhattan Community College, and unfortunately Hurricane Sandy had different ideas, and the college has been flooded. It was flooded out, and it's still on its way back to normal. So we did it here, and Diego and Stefano and the whole crew who is not here, but the whole technical crew, did just wonderful work in creating this room into a type of courthouse and cell and little sort of audience section in the middle. It was truly wonderful. I'm delighted to welcome you all to this event, and I'm delighted that we can, it's almost a year since we did something on Giovannitti last year. And it's important because that, and you'll hear from some of our speakers, because Arturo Giovannitti really represents an important part in, not only in Italian-American history, indeed in Italian-American history, but also in American history. He is someone who is at the forefront of unionization. He was someone who, because in fact of his role in the Bread and Roses strike, because of having to defend himself and two other innocent people, he just is at the forefront of that labor history. Of course, he's also in many ways at the forefront of a type of immigrant history, Italian immigration, and represents, you know, a series of events, tragic events that befell Italian immigrants at both before and immediately after the 20th century. And I of course, have in mind the 1891 lynchings in New Orleans. Of course, this trial that fortunately ended well, and of course, the unfortunate trial not less than or about 15 years later of Sacrin Vanzetti. So there's a real, and of course, that is not just Italian American, but that's American history. It's about how the United States saw its immigrants, and specifically how the United States saw, treated, whatever verb you want to use, Italian immigrants. So we've come in one sense 100 years later, but we've come a year later also because, as I said, we did this in 2011, and it is in many ways the sort of continuation and yet now beginning of yet another sort of step here, and that is the relationship between the Calandra Institute and the Region of Molise, and for that I need to thank, and you'll hear from her later, Silvana Mangione.
After 1 year in New York as Consul General of Italy, where I had the opportunity of meeting very interesting people, active in many different fields and connected in a way or another to Italy, I'm now starting to understand something new, to connect different things, linking the several initiatives organized in New York by Italian or American organization, and to see them as a part of one story, the story of Italians in America. It is thanks to the work of institutions like the Calandra Institute at CUNY that I am now able to better understand the richness of the Italian presence in New York and the United States, the culture supporting its presence, and I can follow, let's say, the fil rouge that connects, for example, a remarkable exhibition at the Grolier Club called Strangers in a Strange Land, where I first heard about Giovannitti, and Stefano Sabelli's play, The Auto da Fe of the Walker. The play, you know better than me, is based on Giovannitti's passionate self-defense speech he pronounced in appeal to the court when he was accused of a crime he did not commit. And is based also on a poem he wrote in prison, The Walker. And this, as you were listening to our Arturo Giovannitti, this is really the story of Giovannitti, who, as many others, was seeking a better and freer future in America. It's just another example of an Italian whose work and life have been an inspiration to many, and whose moral tribute on human dignity and work ethic have contributed to change the history of the United States. Because this is the history of the United States, as Anthony said. In celebrating Arturo Giovannitti, we significantly contribute to reveal the story. I myself am learning right now, every day, the story of the role Italians have played by means of their work and by the safeguard of the dignity of workers in building the United States, a country we continue to love deeply. And so I would like to thank the Calandra Institute, il Consiglio Generale degli Italiani all'Estero, for organizing this event and for bringing Stefano Sabelli's place to the United States. The Consulate General of Italy is really very proud to cooperate with these institutions to bring to the U.S. the most significant expression of the Italian culture.
Sono particolarmente onorato e lieto di essere qui in questa occasione per ricordare un nostro corregionale, un nostro Arturo Giovannitti, che ha fatto tanto onore alla nostra terra. Quindi, sono contento di essere qui per celebrare i 100 anni di quella famosa autodifesa che fece clamore, ebbe successo a livello internazionale, dell'autodifesa di Arturo Giovannitti, che fu arrestato, fu accusato di una cosa ingiusta e seppe così bene, attraverso la sua cultura, le sue grandi capacità, si seppe così difendere da solo, acquistando ancora più, ecco, credenziali nel mondo, soprattutto dei lavoratori. Noi siamo onorati di essere qui e di aver partecipato come istituzioni, anzi colgo anche l'occasione per portare il saluto del Presidente della Regione Molise, che doveva essere qui con noi. Il suo messaggio è riportato sull'opuscolo che era lì all'entrata, insieme anche all'assessore Chieffo, assessore dei molisani nel mondo. Il Molise è una terra che ha dato un grande contributo all'immigrazione, soprattutto nel dopoguerra, tant'è vero che è una piccola regione, una regione di appena 320.000 abitanti, ma 1 milione di molisani sparsi nel mondo, quindi di tante persone che attraverso la loro laboriosità, capacità, intelligenza e preparazione si sono affermati nel mondo, soprattutto nel campo della cultura. Ecco, già col direttore ricordavamo José Rimanelli, sì, che è insomma un nostro corregionale che si è fatto onore qui negli Stati Uniti. Ma è una terra piccola, ricca di natura incontaminata, ricca di storia, di cultura, dai Sanniti ai Romani, alla cultura benedettina. Insomma, abbiamo avuto diverse culture che ci rendono insomma anche una regione attraente, diciamo, e quindi per questo inviterei tutti a visitare la nostra terra, che dal mare alle colline alle montagne può offrire una vacanza veramente particolare, diciamo non usuale in altri territori. Abbiamo voluto essere vicino a questa grande iniziativa di uno spettacolo teatrale che fermamente voluto dal Teatro del Loto di Ferrazzano, attraverso il tuo direttore artistico Stefano Sabelli, che io ringrazio, ma soprattutto attraverso una straordinaria rappresentazione dell'attore principale, che è un talento nostro, della nostra terra, che ha avuto e avrà sicuramente tanto successo, che è Diego Florio, che io lo ringrazio a nome di tutta la provincia di Campobasso. In questa breve permanenza c'è stato molto, ecco, successo nelle comunità italo-molisane americane che abbiamo visitato, dove c'è stata questa rappresentazione, ma anche l'entusiasmo con cui siamo stati accolti, e io non ho potuto fare altro che complimentarmi con questi nostri corregionali per quello che hanno saputo fare, soprattutto nel Connecticut, dove abbiamo visto cose veramente belle e straordinarie. Quindi ripartirò portando con me un'esperienza veramente molto bella, ma soprattutto di essere fiero di essere molisano e della provincia di Campobasso, che possa essere conservata qui lo stemma della nostra, della nostra provincia. E poi avevo preparato, fatto tradurre, però l'ho fatto a braccio il mio intervento. Vabbè, che quello qui lo dice. Ecco, poi dimenticavo, scusatemi, perché poi nella dimenticavo di ringraziare e salutare soprattutto Silvana Mancioni, che ha fatto di tutto per essere qui, insomma è stata un po' l'artefice della nostra missione qui in Nord America. Allora, ecco, questo è scritto in inglese, sarebbe stato il mio intervento, che poi l'ho sintetizzato. Bene. E quindi lo mettiamo, si possa tempo conservare. Bene. Va bene.
Sì. Bene, grazie.
E poi vorrei il console qui per...
Bene, così?
Sì, dai.
Sì, dobbiamo... Sì. Per lui.
Devi aprire anche l'altro.
Va bene, poi il console, volevo farle dono da parte della regione questa per una... una medaglia celebrativa dei 40 anni della istituzione della Regione
della
Molise.
Regione Molise, che bello, grazie. Grazie mille. Grazie.
Okay. I want to talk about my emotion this time in the United States. You know, we got a dream. We got a little dream that became something much more bigger than we could imagine. We start on this performance the 1st of May of 2011. And me and Diego, we work very strong, very hard in our theater, Teatro del Loto, in Ferrazzano, that is where was born also the grandfather and grandmother by Robert De Niro. It's a village. So, how many Molisani you learn since? We conquered with the. Maybe Cristoforo Colombo was Molisano. I don't know. Americo Vespucci, who knows? But, no. I really want to great today. I should talk about the history. I should talk about the story. I should talk about the play. But we are almost at the end of this adventure, and I think it's nice to think to the person that could realize this little dream, Silvana Manzoni, but I'm very happy that there is also Danny Giovannitti tonight. Danny, you have to come to Lawrence. David, sorry. You have to come to Lawrence anyway.
I will come to Lawrence.
You will. Yeah. Okay. You will, absolutely. But image us that we start to make the results of this play in our theater. And after 1 year and a half, we thought about who could be nice to stay in the United States for 23 of November to celebrate the centennial of Arturo Giovannitti address to the jury when he speeches this extraordinary address to the jury. It was something much more great than I think than he could imagine, I think. Because his words are words not for 100 years ago, are words for today. Are really words for today. Are words for every person, every young man, who lives his land, and with a dream, with a hope, go to discovering the world. Goes to searching something that is better than his own life. That this did Arturo Giovannitti. He was a 17 years old guy from Molise. Well, he knows four languages at 17 years old. Yeah, okay, it's not normal. It's not like a normal immigrant. And he arrived in Canada, and then in New York, and then he began to make a. He was a priest, and he was a union trader. What it means? That he was a guy who loves things to the other. Things to the people. Then once that everything can grow up better in this land. And of course, he also has the hope and the dreamer of the United States, because the United States in that period was the first nation, really cosmopolitan. It was a dreamer to stay here for him. It was a dreamer for him to defend everyone needs to be defended. The workers and the people who arrive without insurance, without nothing. That's what's happening. That was happening. And we had a dreamer, me and Diego, to replay this play for the centennial here. Happened, and it's something greater than our own life. That was I mean, yesterday we was in Yale. Couldn't imagine to be in Yale from a Ferrazzano after, you know? Make our show, play our show for the students over there. The truth that was that there are a lot of Italian students over there. And they enjoy it because they was the same, they are here now for an hope, for a new hope of them life. To be something greater than the owner life. I think that an artist needs to do this, needs to do something that is most important than his owner life, own life. And for this, and I thank you. I hope you, and await you, some one of you, why not, in Lawrence, Massachusetts. On 23, to remember all together Giovannitti exactly for the Sentinel, in the same meal, where everything starts, where his incredible story starts. I say the only thing that I say that is included in my script inside here is a. Why Giovannitti saved himself, and the same thing didn't happen to Sacco e Vanzetti. Anyone has this question? Can answer to this question? You know why? Because he was a man of a culture. He knows the words. How our Premio Nobel, Dario Fo, says, the man who knows 1,000 words is the owner, is the boss, and the man who knows 10 words, he has to be done. So the problem is that we have to construct a building of where everyone is owner, at least of his life. At least of his life. And this is the great teachment of Giovannitti today. Sacco e Vanzetti couldn't defend themselves. Couldn't defend because he couldn't speak in English. How Giovannitti did? Oh, of course, there are also other historical situation inside. There was a Russian Revolution. There was other afraid. America probably had much more afraid. Oh, I mean, of the socialism or the Bolshevism, than during the period of Giovannitti, when was the strike of Brenda Rosa strike. But meantime, he really speaked to. Popular jury, knowing much more of the America than the same popular jury of Americans know of this of them nations, of his nations. This was great. This was great. I think that generally stopped our performance here in America and say that. There is only one way for everybody to save the world, and it's the culture, is to know, is the knowledge. And I think that we have to do, nothing else. Know and searching how Giovannitti did for all his life. Thank you so much. Only one remark. It's not cut. No, only one remark. Because it's a feeling for an art, for artists. Inside in this room, I saw where is now. Vabbè, there is Peppe Voltarelli. It's one of the bigger artists we have in Italy. He's a friend of Teatro del Loto, but it's not because he's a friend. Because any time that he comes to Teatro del Loto, he makes some performance incredible. Well, he's here in New York, Pepe, from Calabria. He's doing four concerts. The next one, where is? Next Saturday in New York, in Brooklyn, Pepe. Quando è il prossimo spettacolo? Sabato. Go. Oh, sabato, you have two choices. Or come to Lawrence. If you don't come to Lawrence. No. Lawrence è venerdì. So come to Lawrence and then come. Go to Brooklyn to see this great, great, great artist of Italian. And let me do one last thanks to my regional. He waited for us in New York. He guessed us very well. He made that we could feel at home because the first Sunday that we spent here, he and Rosa prepared for us a big lasagna. So we. So Alfredo Brunetti and Rosas, they have in New York the Molisana Cultural Association. I think I want to great of you. I want to say great thanks to you for everything, and I hope that don't think too close. Don't think too close. The open must be must be open. We need of sliding doors, not closed doors. So, he once said, it's very hard to support Presidente. He said that it's very hard to support our association by alone. We have to do something. That's why, because this cultural presence for us, for every Molisano in the United States, is very important. So go ahead, don't stop, don't close your door, take always the open door. We have, in the Teatro del Loto, we have only open door, we don't close nothing. So anyone that was coming, we wait for you in Ferrazzano.
The first thanks truly go to Anthony Tamburi and the Calandra Institute, because the first time that Giovannitti's name was uttered in this land after Giovannitti had done all that he had done was last year, as you very well remember, when we decided to celebrate the 150th anniversary of the unification of Italy, instead of talking about Cavour e Mazzini e Vittorio Emanuele I, che era invece Vittorio Emanuele II, etc. We all know the history. But we don't know and we do not cherish enough the people of Italian origin who have been living in different countries throughout the world, and they have changed the history of those countries, just like Arturo Giovannitti did 100 years ago, not only through his self-defense, but through the closing arguments of that self-defense, when he says, if you ever acquit me, please know that whenever there will be another strike in this state or in this country, I will be there, and Joe Hector will be there, and we will be there, because the rights of the people, the right to dignity, the right to life, must be kept, must be protected, must be defended. Even the name of this strike, the centennial strike, the strike of which we celebrate the centennial this year, the Bread and Roses strike. That is also a first. No other strike had ever been called the same way. And it comes from a little ugly poem, let's be totally sincere, the poem is not very good, written at the end of the 1800s for women suffragettes, who supposedly, the poet, whose name I'll never remember in my life, even if I try, it's not worth remembering, should leave their gray kitchens, he says, in order to go to the streets and proclaim that they want bread and roses. Bread is survival, but roses are happiness, are beauty, are the right to live a life that is not made only of work, work, work in order to earn enough money, never enough, to be able to keep your family and have it survive. Men and women are much more than just survival. So the beginning was here. And the continuation has been here. And the beginning of the continuation has been here because of Sandy, thank you, Sandy, because la prima americana, the American premiere of L'Auto da Fe del Camminante was in this very room. It would have been at the Manhattan College, as you said. Well, somehow I'm very happy, I'm sorry, because of the reason why we could not do it there, but I'm delighted that there was a reason why we had to do it here, because Calandra has been fundamental, it's been pivotal in creating this new knowledge of Arturo Giovannitti. And now I come to my mantra. Who knows me knows that I've been repeating the same mantra for the last, I would say, 7-8 years. And my mantra is la cultura di ritorno, the untranslatable concept, not translatable literally, but translatable in concept. And that is, we should know more about each other. Italians who reside in Italy should know more about what Italians residing elsewhere throughout history have done to uphold the rights of men, to create beauty, to promote beauty, the one that has been produced in Italy or the one that they have produced themselves, and vice versa. Here in the United States, we should know more about the Italians in Italy who have done fantastic things, and there are so many unknown names that are quite important because they have taught us how to think differently about things that are important in life. So questa cultura di ritorno, that is not the usual figure of the bridge, a bridge between two cultures. No, that's not that. It is let's get to know each other in order to become less provincial. Italy needs badly, at this moment in history, to become less provincial, but also do the United States. Because there has been a tendency in the last few years to close the frontiers, to suffocate this fantastic, marvelous, very free country we all have come to because it was freer, much more open. It promised us the hope and the dream that Stefano Sabelli was talking about. And so we need, it is our duty to create a situation because of which both countries can go back to their own beauty, to their own soul, to their own openness, to their own capability of creating beautiful things for everybody. What have we done? Very quickly, we have been tottering around in the last 15 days. He has been fantastic, Diego Florio, as Arturo Giovannitti reincarnated in one performance after another, and one fantastic lectio brevis that we did at the Fiorello LaGuardia High School. The Consul General was talking about Fiorello LaGuardia. Again, another of those names that in Italy are not known enough, and so we should bring back Fiorello LaGuardia to Italy so they understand the strength of this man who would climb on top of a car, because he was short as I am, in order to be seen by everybody and in order to speak in public. The guy who gave up his Sunday morning when there was a strike of the newspapers in New York because the children would miss their cartoons. And so he was reading and explaining the cartoons to the children over the radio. These are fantastic things. They are the fantastic little things which make lives better for everybody. We have performed in universities, in colleges, in the Calandra Institute, in high schools, here in New York, in the fantastic Scuola d'Italia Guglielmo Marconi. We were supposed to do only one performance, and then a fantastic president said, no, you come back tomorrow, you leave the set up here, because tomorrow the students will come and see it. And we had the joy to have Maestro Tusiani with us on that occasion, who will not be with us tonight, because unfortunately, I think he has got one of those unbearable colds that are circulating around. We have been yesterday in Yale, and there was a lovely debate about Arturo Giovannitti. We have here the second symposium about Arturo Giovannitti. And from here, I would love to get one more thing started, or a couple, or perhaps three things started, that regard not only Giovannitti, but also Molise. Molise is a great region. I fell in love with it ages ago when I came to bring some Italian American photographers to take pictures of American fashion with Italian accessories. I was traveling around with a plastic bag with a huge celery inside, and I had about 50 million lira, which was something at that time, of jewels inside the plastic bag with the celery and the broccoli and the other things on top of it, due guardie del corpo. Anyhow. Molise is a magic region. It has everything. It has beauty, it has strength, it has intelligence, it has culture, it has heart, it has a history. It starts from 700,000 years ago. There are the archaeologists have found incredible traces that we did not know about. And so we need to present Molise better to this community. We did it at ENIT a few nights ago. We had an incredible answer, and people are already writing and asking for more. The second thing is we need to prepare for next year, the Year of Italian Culture in the United States, the third symposium on Giovannitti, but a large one, a big one of those that will be attended by all the universities, and the person who needs to be the head of this movement is sitting right there, and his name is Professor Anthony Tamburi. He has got nothing to do, so we should give him something more to do so that he can fill his days with it. Exactly. And then there is a third thing, and I'll close on this, I promise, or I could talk until tomorrow morning because I love Molise truly. There is a marvelous scholarly review published in Molise called Glocale, the global and local. You know that Piero Bassetti has a very high level of research in this field, and he loves to talk about glocalism. But localism needs to have a land in which it should put its roots. And that perfect land is Molise. 300,000 people in Molise, 1 million Molisani around the world. And therefore, the globe is there because it is owned by the 1 million Molisani around the world. And the local is there because the region is more. It is perfect. I have presented two copies of it tonight to Anthony Tamburi. He cannot give us an answer right now. But I am trying to convince him publicly to take a deep look at that and to see if Calandra Institute can become, again, the instrument to make it known, to make it enter into the circulation of the academia, so that what is being done very beautifully by them should become known to everybody in the name of the region of Molise.
Se Dante non avesse avuto Beatrice, non avremmo avuto la Divina Commedia, perché accompagnato a Dante in tutti i meandri che ha fatto visitare, così la nostra Silvana ci ha introdotto in America insieme a Brunetti e a Rosa, che ci hanno introdotto in America e hanno introdotto la possibilità di riportare Arturo Giovannitti qui in America. Quindi un grazie e mi associo alle parole del presidente della provincia per un ringraziamento per poter essere qui. Una sede prestigiosa, per stare in altre sedi prestigiose, dove si fa cultura, e Arturo Giovannitti era un uomo di cultura, era un uomo colto. Ed era per la prima volta che un gruppo di italiani, fine dell'Ottocento, inizio del Novecento, per svariati motivi, spesso per idee, allora abbracciavano le prime idee del socialismo in Italia, si trovano perseguitati e pensano, immagino, di venire in America, una terra promessa, e di una nuova democrazia, e costruire una nuova democrazia in America. Era affascinante per questi giovani pensare all'America e contribuire alla crescita negli Stati Uniti d'America, la nuova frontiera. E Arturo Giovannitti, che partecipa a delle lotte sindacali dell'occupazione delle terre a Ripa Bottoni, suo paese nativo, è figlio di un farmacista, quindi di un borghese, che lo dice anche lui nelle sue poesie, lo dice nell'autodifesa. Lui ha respirato la democrazia in casa dal padre e ha conosciuto Mazzini, ha conosciuto i grandi poeti. E poi è stato educato in uno dei più prestigiosi collegi nelle scuole del Mezzogiorno d'Italia, il Mario Pagani, dove il professore era il professor Gentile, che sarà successivamente ministro della cultura in Italia, è stato il suo docente in Italia e a Campobasso, dove ha frequentato l'istituto, il liceo. Naturalmente a 17 anni Arturo Giovannitti, il padre di Giovannitti, è consigliato dalle autorità di far andare suo figlio fuori. Ecco, forse ha questo piccolo privilegio di capire che è opportuno che non stia più in Italia. Ma non viene negli Stati Uniti d'America, ma in Canada. Perché c'è una comunità, come tante comunità dell'Italia meridionale, e di lavoratori che negli Stati Uniti d'America e in Canada dalla religione cattolica partono come cattolici, diventano evangelici, perché l'azione della Chiesa protestante evangelica è molto vicina ai lavoratori e sta sul posto di lavoro. I minatori, in modo particolare, ma il tessile, in tutte le aziende dove il lavoro italiano c'è, la Chiesa evangelica sta vicino a loro. E quindi c'è una comunità del suo paese, una vicina di casa, che lui va in Canada e incontra una delle menti più fervide culturalmente, allora in Italia, in Europa, ma anche in America, Taglia la Tela, che è una grande esempio di evangelizzazione apostolica in Europa e in America, dove capisce subito il livello culturale, che è il bagaglio culturale di questo giovane, e viene, come dire, introdotto come pastore evangelico e fatto studiare alla McGill in Canada, dove approfondisce la sua cultura e della Chiesa protestante, e viene mandato in Pennsylvania a predicare, l'ultimo tra gli ultimi che va nella predicazione. Ma negli Stati Uniti d'America c'era un fermento. Nel 1900, De Chambis racconta che nel 1905-1906, quando venne Giovannitti negli Stati Uniti d'America, c'era un fermento, come dire, culturale, perché erano aumentate le presenze di fuoriusciti dall'Italia. Ma c'era anche una miseria, uno sfruttamento operaio spaventoso. Le testimonianze riportano che l'attività dei nostri lavoratori, i vari giornali, è andata a sostituire nell'America sassone specialmente gli schiavi negri nel lavoro brutale e macchinale. Il desiderio di accumulare il risparmio che l'assillante preoccupazione della famiglia spinta a cercare oltre il lide della patria, li induce a sforzarsi in soprumano lavoro bestiale, che durando questo lavoro finisce con fiaccarle le energie. Naturalmente sono tutti colpiti dalle malattie più comuni. C'è quasi uno sterminio di lavoratori. Ieri il professor Forand ci ha mostrato un quadro di riferimento tra i lavoratori del tessile, è impressionante, una mortalità dimezzata tra i lavoratori del tessile e gli avvocati ed altre e i preti, altre categorie sociali, che 64 anni, 35 anni, e in più una mortalità giovanile. Era una condizione estrema. Nel 1906 poi ci fu una delle più grandi tragedie della storia del mondo ancora oggi, quello della miniera di Monongah, dove muoiono 965 minatori il 6 di di dicembre del 1906, di cui 227 italiani, la comunità più numerosa, e 101 molisani. Ed è l'anno quindi che nasce l'Industrial Worker in the World, e di cui Arturo Giovannitti aderisce a questo progetto, rinunciando alla predicazione evangelica, ritenendola forse non sufficiente per alleviare le condizioni dei lavoratori, degli emigrati in genere, e aderisce al Partito Socialista. E c'è qui una battuta ancora di De Ciampis che racconta un po' la vita del movimento sindacale, dove riconsidera che Arturo Giovannitti ha fatto per ben due volte la domanda di essere iscritto al Partito Socialista, però c'era un requisito, se era credente. E lui rispose di sì e non venne ammesso al Partito Socialista. Quando disse che era agnostico, allora venne accettato al Partito Socialista. E qui inizia a collaborare con il Proletario, allora diretto da Tresca. Ho visto, Anthony, che avete fatto anche come Calandra una bella iniziativa, che Giovannitti lì descrive quell'iniziativa lì, di onorare la statua di Garibaldi e di difenderlo dall'assalto dei fascisti. Vanno in galera lui, Tresca e la Flynn, vengono imprigionati perché vanno a difendere l'italianità di Garibaldi e il valore di Mazzini. E c'è stato questo bel convegno che ho visto, il manifesto, una testimonianza straordinaria. Lui lo racconta sul Proletario questa storia. Dalla mattina, quando si sono alzati, vanno lì a presidiare, e quando finiscono, insomma, fanno il tafferugli e vengono poi arrestati, naturalmente, uno dei tanti arresti che ha subito Arturo Giovannitti in difesa degli idei della democrazia e della libertà. Ma la condizione del 1906, dicevo, è una condizione sociale per gli immigrati spaventosa. Tra l'altro, gli italiani non avevano una dignità o uno status. Gli italiani erano i crumiri, cioè erano quei personaggi che venivano chiamati dal padronato, venivano caricati sul camion e andavano a sostituire i lavoratori in sciopero. Quindi erano anche disprezzati sotto il profilo da altri lavoratori. Ed era questa la condizione in cui si rappresentava, oltre a essere mafiosi, naturalmente sembra la solita etichetta degli italiani. C'era anche un'altra considerazione, che il sindacato ufficiale di Campers non organizzava i lavoratori senza qualifica. Pertanto tutti gli emigrati erano senza qualifica, non solo gli italiani, tutti. E non erano sindacatalizzabili, quindi non avevano i diritti. E l'Industrial Worker in the World, invece, considera questo aspetto della sindacalizzazione dei non qualificati, secondo un principio di sindacalizzazione europea, e organizza questi lavoratori. Qui è il concetto dove si inserisce l'azione sindacale dell'Industrial Worker in the World. E qui inizia l'azione politica sindacale di questa generazione. Giovannitti non è un sindacalista. Giovannitti lo ricorderà Prezzolini quando morirà, l'unico nel 1960 che lo ricorderà nel Bardo della Libertà, perché Giovannitti ne è stato amico di Prezzolini quando venne qui in America, e dice che era il Bardo della Libertà, dal caldo eloquio, vale a dire che veniva utilizzato per parlare alla folla, perché era immaginifico la sua visione del mondo, ed era una voce forte, calda. Aveva studiato, insomma, predicazione anche, no? Ma era colto, che è un valore che si accompagna sempre alla storia di Arturo Giovannitti e di quella storia dell'emigrazione italiana, perché va riconsiderata quella, senza escludere niente, ma va riconsiderata meglio questo aspetto di questa emigrazione. Quindi Giovannitti non va subito a Lawrence, ma ci va dopo che sono stati arrestati i sindacalisti. La Flynn, Big Wood, vabbè, Water, vengono arrestati e va, lui viene chiamato per parlare e per organizzare insieme a Hector, che era lui, era il sindacalista, Joe Hector. E naturalmente, come è stato raccontato già, come sapete la storia, come potete seguire nella bella pubblicazione, mi complimento Anthony, la bella pubblicazione curata dal Calandra che c'è a disposizione, c'è la storia quindi di quella giornata. E arriviamo, per chiudere, arriviamo, se non il cartellino giallo, vero?
No.
No, perché la seconda è rosso, mi ha detto. chiudo con questa parte del programma di cui nel 1912 perché si mobilita il mondo intero? Non è l'America, non è gli Stati Uniti d'America che si mobilita o una parte del sindacalismo. Si riaprono le coscienze in America e in Europa e nel mondo sulla condizione operaia e sul rapporto tra capitalismo e produzione. Si riaprono le considerazioni e si prende maggior coscienza di questa situazione nuova. E naturalmente lo si prende attraverso un uomo che lancia, perché le poesie di Arturo Giovannitti sono pubblicate in tutti i giornali, che quest'uomo, che è un uomo colto, che senza interesse, non è operaio, che lavora e sta in America per l'emancipazione delle classi subalterne, per la libertà e per il nuovo spirito, come avete potuto vedere dalla sua autodifesa, con quale spirito sta qui in America, e, ecco, è universale il messaggio di Arturo Giovannitti, è universale, della nuova frontiera. E al centro c'è l'uomo. Quindi questa è la forza di Arturo Giovannitti. Naturalmente in Italia, nel Molise, c'è l'associazione Pro Arturo Giovannitti, di cui io ho rifondato, si mobilitano deputati, c'è il Parlamento italiano che ci sono interrogazioni, Mussolini allora massimalista, Partito Socialista, comizi in tutta Italia per liberare Arturo Giovannitti, manifestazione in tutta Italia, Parma lo propone come deputato al Parlamento italiano, Milano, Torino, Genova, Roma, Napoli, Bari, tutta Italia che arrivano messaggi in America, soldi per la difesa e messaggi di sostegno all'azione di Arturo Giovannitti. Allora è un personaggio di uno spessore unico, di grande valore in un periodo storico particolare, di grande cambiamento della produzione e del rapporto tra produzione e lavoratore. Io qui va inquadrato il personaggio, io chiudo qui perché ho la faccia lunga, però voglio soltanto ritornare su un argomento, l'argomento della cultura. Stiamo in una università prestigiosa e questo elemento culturale credo che vada riproposta. Lo ripropongo con una poesia di Arturo Giovannitti, perché non è solo It Walk, che è il massimo della sua, almeno anche secondo il professor Tusiani, di cui abbiamo avuto il privilegio di averlo insieme a Campobasso, David ci è venuto a trovare a Campobasso in un simposio internazionale che abbiamo fatto su Giovannitti, ti ringraziamo. Il professor Tusiani considera che The Walker è il massimo di un'espressione di Arturo Giovannitti, e indubbiamente sulla poesia di Arturo Giovannitti. No, voi dovete considerare che Arturo Giovannitti era, come dire, considerato, si ispirava al Carducci, a Rapisardi, a Whitman, era il nostro Whitman, Arturo Giovannitti. E io preferisco ricordarli in una sede come questa, su una piccola poesia che inverte la considerazione che tutti noi abbiamo avuto da quando eravamo piccoli nella storia, nel racconto, nella favola di Esopo, poi di Fedro, che è tradotto dal greco al latino, la cicala e la formica. Sapete che questa favola c'ha la morale, no? Che questa formichina così prudente, così laboriosa, prende il chicco di grano e lo riporta nella sua tana e accumula l'estate, è laboriosa, è un'accumulazione costante perché è previdente, è brava, è ritmica, e arriva ad accumulare per l'inverno il suo patrimonio. E naturalmente la cicala, che faceva la cicala, dice Fedro, cantava. La morale qual era? Che la cicala è arrivata in inverno, non ha da mangiare, e la formichina ha da mangiare, dice, beh, tu hai cantato. E dice, quindi va premiato chi ha lavorato. E Giovannitti inverte questo concetto. È sbagliato. E vi dico perché, ve la leggerò, perché è sbagliato. Ci hanno educato male. Questa morale non va. Alla cicala, disse la formica, non ti posso aiutare, mia bella amica. Ma che facesti tu da sera a mane mentre io sudavo a guadagnar il pane? Io, rispose l'insetto moribondo, ho cantato e sorretto il cor del mondo. La cultura ha un valore o no? E qui, è Arturo Giovannitti.
I want to take up a question that could eventually become a debate in Giovannitti criticism. I say could eventually because I don't think there really is any Giovannitti criticism to speak of, at least not in English. But there is a little passage in Prezzolini's essay on Carnevale. He contrasts Giovannitti with Carnevale. Carnevale, for those of you who don't know his work, was a wunderkind of Italian-American poetry. He came here and he almost immediately learned English. Within a very short amount of time, he was being published in Poetry Magazine in all these wonderful places. He was a friend of Ezra Pound and Harriet Monroe, the founder of Poetry Magazine. And after 8 years, he went back to Italy and got sick and eventually died. And Prezzolini, partly because he was un uomo raffinato, and partly because I think he was a fascist, really did not like the aspect of Giovannitti that we have been talking about here. And he says about his poetry, I won't go through the whole thing, but he says, la sua poesia veduta oggi ci appare allungata con eloquenza e scarsa di sensibilità. His poetry, seen today, looks to us as if it had been filled out with eloquence, which is not a polite word in his language, and without a lot of sensibility. Fondata di figure di giudici e di condannati, di ricchi e di poveri, di ribelli e di carcieri, che son generiche ed astratte. That it was based on figures of judges and the condemned, of the rich and the poor, of rebels and prisoners that are generic and abstract. These are not nice things to say about a poem. Le sue rime raccolte nel volume Arrows in the Gale rivelano i modelli tradizionali di Whitman, di Poe, e di Oscar Wilde. His poems collected in his volume Arrows in the Gale reveal the traditional models of Whitman, Poe, and Oscar Wilde. Now, that's really nasty, because after all, I don't think that any of those poets were really traditional in 1912. La sua lingua è certamente ricca ma studiata. His language is certainly rich, but very studied, ricercata. E sembra tutta calcolata per fare esercizi di scale oratorie ed arrivare al finale con una conclusione sonora, come in un comizio. In other words, he accuses him of his very virtues. However, this is a definite problematic in the criticism of poetry, because these are things that we supposedly really don't like in poetry. So with that background, I want to turn now to talking a little bit about Giovannitti and his writings, and I'll read some of the passages and talk about them against this background and try to indicate what this debate might consist of if we actually were to have it. And the paper, by the way, this is a revision of a paper I gave last year, but I kept the title because it's more appropriate this year than it was last year. The paper is called A Poet's Perfect Storm. Now, I didn't cause it, but there it is. The first perfect storm in Italian-American literature took place in the years 1912 through 1914. As often happens with perfect storms, this one was ancillary, almost a casual result of another sort of event altogether. The event was a strike by the industrial workers of the world, also called the Wobblies, the first major union, as we have just heard, to organize industrial, as distinct from craft workers, in the United States. On January 12, 1912, 20,000 workers at the textile mills in Lawrence, Massachusetts, went out on strike. A new law had shortened, this is a great story, this is worthy of Mitt Romney. A new law had shortened their work week to 54 hours. That was the short one. This had been a victory for the workers, but the plant owners retaliated by reducing their pay to reflect the shorter hours, and at the same time, they speeded up the machines so that the production would remain the same. I mean, nothing changes, apparently. Couldn't you see Romney doing this? And then, well, we could go on about that, but we won't, okay. The workers asserted that their pay had been reduced arbitrarily by the owners. They calculated their loss as the price of 3 loaves of bread. So the labor action became known as the Bread and Roses Strike. And of course, the poem was involved in that too. And it was remarkably successful. This is a very important point here. The IWW organized a series of peaceful demonstrations. I'm sure Giovannitti had a hand in that. Strikers marched en masse, an action that certainly accomplished the workers' goal of unnerving the proprietors, scaring them to death, actually, which apparently is a lot easier to do than you would think. Apparently, the Koch brothers are terrified that all the poor Puerto Ricans in Cleveland are going to overthrow them and go home with their boats and things. On January 26th, 14 days into the strike, a policeman opened fire on the marchers, killing a young woman named Anna LoPizzo. The authorities arrested a striker named Joseph Caruso on suspicion of murder, and they also arrested the strike's two principal organizers, Joseph Ettore, a Wobbly organizer, and Arturo Giovannitti, a radical journalist and organizer. And they, as that's how he appeared then, and they charged these two with a hanging offense, that of being accessories before the fact in a capital crime. The IWW did not back down. They sent up to Lawrence a series of labor leaders of great renown, their biggest guns, Big Bill Hayward, Elizabeth Gurley Flynn, and the anarchist Carlo Tresca, who unfortunately didn't speak English very well either. But certainly Elizabeth Gurley Flynn did. And I think that she was his lover at this point. And she was a great communist bête noire of every Republican who ever lived, as long as she lived anyway. These leaders knew how to beat the drum, and the strike in Lawrence became a major event everywhere. One of the high points, and perhaps the turning point of this strike, came when in late February, the organizers started shipping children of strikers out of Lawrence to be cared for in other cities. This was a tactic that they had actually taken from a strike in Parma. It wasn't invented in Lawrence. Of the 120 of these children who arrived in New York City, most were so poorly dressed that only 4 of them had underwear. Now, the newspapers loved this. The labor and the radical press made the most of these things, and the burghers of Lawrence, the millionaires of Lawrence, began to feel the tide of public opinion turning against them. I like to think of how Romney and that other fellow with the pointed hat, what's his name? The
vice president candidate?
I
can't ever remember his name. How it finally dawned on them at around 11:30 that they had lost the election. They couldn't believe it because they had been surrounded by flatterers for weeks and weeks telling them they were winning. And that's sort of what happened among these rich people in Lawrence. They didn't think it was possible for these miserable immigrants to do this to them, but they did. Since the yearly output of the Lawrence mills was about $45 million, which is a lot of money now, imagine what it was 100 years ago, the owners were more than a little afraid that they were losing their hold on the political imagination, and in mid-March, after 2 months, they settled the strike. But Ettore, Caruso, and Giovannitti were still in jail. Giovannitti, it needs to be noted, and it's an element in the perfect storm, did not have working class roots. I've heard this before, but it's material here. He was from a middle-class family in Molise. His father was a pharmacist, and others among his forebears were even doctors and notaries, which I think is better than a pharmacist in Italy, right? Not like a notary in Italy is like a lawyer who gets his hands in your okay. He did his liceo in Ripa Bottoni, where he was born, and he emigrated to Canada, where he studied at McGill and became a minister. You already heard. Thus, he already had a sound background of living the social gospel, a little bit like Barack Obama, when he later moved into union organizing. He was, in short, all things a good progressive ought to be, a labor organizer, but not in any sense of the word a terrorist. He was, a minister. And, Protestant ministers are not like priests. I mean, there is a kind of pasta they call strozza preti. And I love that because it suggests a lot about the way people really feel about priests in Italy. And you don't have that about Protestant ministers, especially in those days. They were nice, very, very nice people. Very nice people, they eat very bland food. They do. And when they commit adultery, they do it very quietly upstairs. It's true, isn't it? He was a strike leader, but one who practiced peaceful non-resistance. When the police of Salem, Massachusetts put him in jail, they produced two elements they had not quite reckoned with. Now, this is where it becomes a perfect story. He wasn't just another radical or just another WOP. He was a competent poet. He wasn't a great poet. Okay, let's admit that right from the start. But he was a very competent poet. And we'll see in a minute how competent. Second, like anyone trained in the Liceo Classico, he was a competent orator. And we'll get to that in a minute, too. And of course, this is what was so lacking to poor Sacco and Vanzetti. They didn't have really an education. And there was, I'm going to show you, the one thing that they forgot to do that Giovannitti did that really turned the trick. Because I also have a classical education, so I recognized it myself. These two aspects of Giovannitti now came into play, and they were magnified by this situation. It's a little bit like, when Sandy suddenly joined forces with that nor'easter, and instead of just another hurricane that destroys a few speedboats, it was the end of the world. The half of Manhattan sank. There's still mud in the Brooklyn Battery Tunnel. The R train still doesn't cross the East River. I mean, it's a mess. And of course, Staten Island, we don't even talk about that here because it's too depressing and too sad. And at the same time, there were blizzards in West Virginia, all part of this same thing. That's what we mean by a perfect storm. Things coming together that by themselves are nothing much. But when you put them together, kaboom. And that's what happened here. Giovannitti and his comrades were left in jail for 10 months. 10 months, and being tried on a capital crime for basically giving a speech. Even then, that was a bit of a stretch. Caruso was accused of murder. Ettore and Giovannitti were accused of having suggested, stimulated, and provoked this violent act. All three of them might have been hung. Day after day, they remained in jail. Outside, Tresca, Flynn, Haywood were speaking, organizing, spreading the word about what had taken place in Salem. Jail was not a human condition Giovannitti had ever experienced. And also, let me just go back to the previous sentence, not only were those three people speaking, but the Wobblies, who at this point were only about 5 or 6 years old, were very much in the phase of growth. They were, and so again, That's the, the hurricane meeting with the nor'easter. Nobody expected this to happen. This became a world event. Giovannitti was just the right to be in the middle of this because he was an innocent, like all these Protestant ministers in those days. He was a sweet fellow who believed in, Jesus and the social gospel and everything is going to be. Bernard Shaw writes a lot of plays about people like this. Candida has a minister in it like this. Very idealistic, nice people who wouldn't hurt a fly. And there he was in jail being tried for murder. And he could have been hung. Came very close. He was stirred himself. There's another part of the storm. In a way that he never had experienced before and never had expected to experience. This is a guy who probably never... could you park illegally in 1912? Probably not. But if he could have, he wouldn't have. Is that right? Yeah. Now he wrote with a bluntness of perception we actually can legitimately associate with Whitman's great poem, The Sleepers. And a clarity of feeling we can also associate with Oscar Wilde's The Ballad of Reading Jail. Why Prezzolini thinks that these are insults tells you more about Prezzolini than it tells you about anything else. Great man, Prezzolini, mind you, but difficult. So I'm going to read you just a little bit of this poem. And at this point, a little bit of the classical education comes in and see if you can find it. I hear footsteps over my head all night. They come and they go. And again, they come and they go all night. They come one eternity in four paces. And they go one eternity in four paces. And between the coming and the going, there is silence and the night and the infinite. For infinite are the 9 feet of a prison cell. And then endless is the march of him who walks between the yellow brick wall and the red iron gate, thinking things that cannot be chained and cannot be locked, but that wander far away in the sunlit world, each in a wild pilgrimage after a destined goal. Now that is a paragraph of verse that Carnevale would never have perpetrated, because it is actually a kind of an adaptation of the paradox of Zeno, right? The one eternity in four paces, another eternity in four paces, and between the coming and going, there's silence and night and the infinite. So he can't keep himself from being a schoolmaster, even when he's talking about death and terror and all the rest of it. And this is something that the audience in this particular situation, not any other conceivable situation, but in this particular situation, found on the one hand stirring, and on the other hand, and this is very important, strangely consoling. Here is, as you said before, and as you said before, un uomo di cultura. He can't even be al punto di morte without thinking about Greek philosophy and working it in, so that in case you're un buon ragazzo del terzo liceo, you'll see it there. Okay. The poem is called The Walker, Il Camminante. He wrote it in both English and Italian, as he often did. Actually, I prefer his, yes, another poem called Nina Nanna Sanita, which is really a killer. I think it's a better poem than this, actually. But it didn't get famous because there was no perfect storm, really. In the walker, pressed by danger, nay, terror of the situation, at the same time stimulated by the sense of occupying the eye of a great storm outside the jailhouse, which he perfectly well understood. He was very smart. He may have been a little innocent, but he didn't miss much. Giovannitti takes possession, or is himself possessed by, the great 19th century voice of the outsider, the cursed poet. Now, this is not Giovannitti's character. Like I say, this is a guy who should be, giving a Sunday afternoon talk to the Boy Scouts or something. He's got that about him. But he's got this moral force, which is something special, and that got swept up in all of this. The next part of the poem subsumes the obsessive voice of Edgar Allan Poe, another sarcasm of Prezzolini's, which, as far as I'm concerned, shows that Giovannitti knew his trade. Throughout the restless night, I hear the footsteps over my head. Who walks? I know not. It is the phantom of the jail, the sleepless brain, the man, the walker. Now, it could be the soundtrack of a Vincent Price movie, no question. Not so bad. One, two, three, four. Four paces and the wall. One, two, three, four. Four paces and the iron gate. Last week when they did this, they had the wall at one end and the iron gate at the other. It was very effective. He has measured his space. He has measured it accurately, scrupulously, minutely. See, now, he wouldn't be a wobbly himself because he knows how to measure. You know, he would have a one of those, what do you call those little things that you measure things with? No. Toolmakers use them. A micrometer. He could have a micrometer in his pocket, this guy. Okay. As the hangman measures the rope and the grave digger, the coffin, so many feet, so many inches, so many fractions of an inch for each of the four paces. See, he can't help thinking this way because he spent his whole damn life in school. And it comes out. Each step sounds heavy and hollow over my head. And the echo of each step sounds hollow within my head as I count them in suspense and in dread that once, perhaps, in the endless walk, there may be five steps instead of four between the yellow brick wall and the red iron gate. But he has measured his space so accurately, so scrupulously, so minutely that nothing breaks the grave rhythm of the slow, fantastic march. Now, what has happened here is that he has taken his own uomo colto and he has projected it onto this other person who is really the boss walking, death walking over his head. So that makes it an interesting poem. Never mind Edgar Allan Poe. It makes it an interesting poem. It's alive, this poem. It's not the best poem that ever was ever written, but it's alive. Poet has been shaken to his core. He projects it onto the ceiling, onto the walls, everywhere. No other work of Giovannitti's harps so relentlessly on the essential, the existential, the bare bones of the human situation. He finds himself as alone as Whitman in The Sleepers, but unlike Whitman, he cannot gaze across the whole world of night and of dreams. Instead, he is alone with the scythe of time. Now, I have a passage about that, but I'm going to skip it because this is getting to be too long. If you want to hear it later, take me in the corner and I'll read it to you. Okay? Well, now, the other part of the storm that they unleashed without knowing is that not only was he a competent poet, but he was a really competent orator. Because after all, you know, when you go to a Liceo Classico, You read Virgil, you read Ovid, and if you're a poet, you learn to write poetry. But even if you're not a poet, you read Quintilian, and you read Cicero, and what?
Caesar.
But especially Cicero, Cicerone, above all. And you learn how to give a speech. When Giovannitti was writing his astonishing poem, he and his two comrades were rotting in jail. The charges were unbailable. They couldn't get out. From February to September, nothing happened. That's a long time to be in jail, and of all places, Salem, Massachusetts, where they used to hang witches. And of course, Giovannitti knew all about that. 500 potential jurors were dismissed. 500, could you imagine? There were 5 weeks of testimony, mostly, according to the Wobbly's pamphlet on the subject, testimony by private detectives, city police, state police, militiamen, and the paid tools and thugs of the capitalist class. Now, they don't write thugs like that anymore. You know, I mean, I would have loved to hear a little bit of that during the election. I mean, some of these people who talk on, never mind Fox, CNN even, like, please, can you sleep at night? The district attorney summed up the case for a day and a half. Ettore and Giovannitti both felt they had to speak. Ettore's address, just printed, was capable, calm, and well-reasoned. But Giovannitti's was classical oration. I cannot do it justice, but I can suggest something of its power. More than once, now, this is the key. This is what Sacco, even Vanzetti, who understood some of these things, did not know how to do. He appeals to the jury's goodwill by invoking his own humility. This is an expression we have from Cicero, captatio benevolentiae. Captatio benevolentiae. You capture
the goodwill of the audience by heaping ashes on your own head. And he never does it to better effect than when he is refuting the district attorney's charge that he and his fellow unionists are anti-patriotic. And he says, I mean, he's so blunt, it's beautiful. He says, I'm very humble. I am very low in my own appreciation of myself. Can you hear me? I'm sorry. Only when I'm yelling can you hear me. I'll start again. He says, I am very humble. I'm very low in my own appreciation of myself. And I'm sure that this is how he said it. I'm sure he talked very softly so that they had to strain a little bit to hear him. I have been in the background during this trial. You probably never even saw me. I'd throw that in here and say that. I have never talked to any American audience. We heard this before. I, the man from Italy, have not told them how they should run their business. I am not here now to tell you what the future of this country should be. I know this, though, that I come from a land, and this is my very favorite part of the whole thing, I come from a land which has been under the rod of oppression for thousands of years, oppressed by the autocracy of old. Oppressed during the Middle Ages by all the nations of Europe, by all the Vandals that passed through it. And now Italy is oppressed, I may say, even by the present authority, as I am not a believer in kingship and monarchy. And I, gentlemen of the jury, since I was a little boy, have learned upon the knees of my mother and father to reverence with tears in my eyes the name of a republic. Let me just pause there for a second. You know, not everybody remembers that the Risorgimento was celebrated as a victory in the same way that a bunch of gangsters celebrate winning at Monte Carlo. The people who won got fucking rich, excuse me, got really rich. And then there were a whole bunch of other people who had been followers of Giuseppe Mazzini who believed that they were going to build a republic. And in the end, what they got was that their Jesus Christ, Giuseppe Garibaldi, turned the whole thing over to this buffoon with his ridiculous mustache and turned it into another casino, which the ghost of which sopravvive ancora, secondo me. I mean, it seems that way to me. Anyway, I don't have an opinion either, after all. When I came to this country, it was because I was coming to a better and freer land than my own. It was not exactly hunger that drove me out of my house. My father had enough money saved, and he had enough energy saved to go and give an education to my brothers. He could have done the same with me. And I could now be a professional man down there. He says, down there. It's so nice. Such a nice little immigrant mistake. But I thought I could visit the world. Another beautiful, I mean, that's palm oil by itself. But I thought I could visit the world. And I desired coming here for that purpose. I have no grudge against this country. I have no grudge against the American flag. Now, this is what Vanzetti forgot to do. Vanzetti's speech to the judge or the jury, whoever it was, is full of resentment, anger, sarcasm, beautifully expressed, a great poem, really. But he doesn't do this. This is what a good classical education does for you. Did you say Giovanni Gentile was his teacher? I didn't know that. That's great to know.
I have very little to add to the eloquent speeches we've heard tonight, simply because I really don't have the capabilities that all the professors and more, you know, scholars here who have come before me have. But what's been, obviously I'm in a very unusual position here because none of this is abstract to me. This is my grandfather. This is my history. You know, everything that has been discussed about my grandfather, I bear the genetic marks of all of this because I'm a little speechless here. You have to forgive me. There's so many threads of this that I would like to bring together, and I really don't have the eloquence, but I came across something recently as I was going through some of my grandfather's papers, and I just wanted to share that briefly with you, which is my father was also a writer. He was a novelist and a filmmaker, and in fact had a very difficult relationship with his father, as one would imagine, being a writer with a very eminent writer father, et cetera, et cetera. And they had a lot of difficulty, although even within that, all of the values that have been discussed by everyone here that my grandfather, I think, did his best to espouse and to live were absolutely transmitted to his father and then to me, and I have done the same with my kids. And, you know, they are, my youngest daughter now is studying at Hunter College and is actually a religion major, of all things, and is very interested in doing work around issues of prisoners' rights and things like that. And it kind of brings me right to this piece because I came across an unpublished thing that my father wrote that I had never seen, and it was extraordinarily striking to me because I think it encompasses everything that everyone has spoken about. And this is a quote from my own father, whose name was Len. His name was Lenin Giovannitti, which he shortened. Yeah. He shortened to Len after a college professor failed him for having the name Lenin. Wow. And that, he failed him, you know, a priori, like before any of the classwork had come in just because of his name. So then this was in, the, you know, at St. John's University.
In the 50s.
In the 50s, yeah. I mean, or 40s. Maybe, but this little quote is from my own father, and he said, my father, speaking of Arturo, he said, my father taught me to seek justice always. He loved that word more than liberty or freedom or right. He would become zealous and his eyes would flash when he spoke of the need for justice was the antithesis of tyranny. And I mean, I think that little paragraph. And this was written in 1950, and clearly that passion for justice animated everything that we've all spoken about tonight, and it's just kind of extraordinary to me how that kind of a passion, an abstract passion, if you will, for doing the right thing and for the rights of, you know, working people and, you know, the salt of the earth, so to speak, was really the thing that animated my father, you know, my grandfather, my father, myself, my kids. And this is what keeps the world going. And I think to be really, you know, not to get too, you know, teary-eyed here, as it were, but in all the references to the current election and so forth, clearly the reason Obama won this election is they had the people on the ground. You know, the Calandra Institute, these kinds of meetings, people talking together, people communicating on a very, very one-to-one level is what it's all about. I mean, there's all this kind of huge things that take place on the world stage that we all feel extraordinary frustration over, that we cannot affect and cannot control, and we're just pawns in the vast chess game and so forth. But I think this recent election and a lot of the things that we talked about tonight, the Lawrence strike itself and everything that took place there, is evidence of what ordinary, normal people can do. And in particular, you know, when my grandfather found himself in a very extraordinary situation, he somehow found the wherewithal to make a speech that, you know, probably saved him, saved his life. I mean, I think in a lot of ways, I mean, and, you know, obviously what Joe Etter said and what everybody said, but I think in some ways the fact that he could reach down and say, you know, whatever comes, if you free me, I am now going to go and, you know, be at the next strike and be at the next, whoever needs my assistance, we're going to be there. I mean, that's the reason I am here today, obviously, in a literal sense. So it's just very, very moving to me that here we are 100 years later, and, you know, the stone that he threw in the pond in 1912, the ripples are still going out now, and it's really a credit to everyone who participates in this process, you know, not so much to him, but to the fact that these are... This is what's required to move the world forward and to keep civilization going and to not let, you know, just the few live off the labor of the many and, you know, be in that position. So it's just, I really, if I had the time to write, I have a little bit of the gift of my grandfather when I have the time of writing things down. But as you can see, I'm really, you know, a little overwhelmed here this evening. But it's The one little thing that I wrote after this thing about justice is simply that I think if anything right now, the world we live in now requires justice even more than my grandfather's time, if for no other reason than the damage that can be done by the unjust is so much greater due to the technology that everyone, you know, has a hold of. And, you know, I'm constantly aware of the continued relevance of the struggle that my grandfather was so much a part of, and that this struggle for justice and dignity is truly never ending. It's really kind of ironic that in 2012, 100 years after the Lawrence strike, in the state of Wisconsin, a state long considered a bastion of enlightened social policy, working people were stripped of the right to bargain collectively, a right that had been taken for granted for decades. This work, the work of making, you know, the work that you have all done here and that everyone, you know, who's participated done, the work of making history come alive so that those who either forgot it or never knew about it can understand that we are all part of a larger narrative whose ending has not yet been written is perhaps the most critical task that we all face. And I just think, I really can't thank Anthony Tamburi, the Calandra Institute, and everyone, Stefano, everyone who's participated in this tonight. I know that all of my forebears are smiling somewhere in the most cliche that this is all being carried on in the spirit that they would, you know, wish it to be.
When you were talking about justice. I just kept thinking of those kids that they sent to New York, these kids who didn't have underwear. This was at the beginning of February. You know, it's cold in Lawrence, Massachusetts.
And they had short shorts. Right.
Yes. Somehow I had forgotten that point. I just wanted to throw that.
Okay. Thank you very, very much. Thank you very much.
It was very necessary to discover him more, Arturo Giovannitti. Is the author of this book. Is Norberto Lombardi. Yeah. We need absolutely his work. As we needed the work of Antonio to discover Arturo Giovannitti. Yes. We couldn't do the show without Norberto, really. And so I think that it's nice to remember him. Yes. Exactly.
Stefano mentioned the editor of this book, Norberto Lombardi, who lives in Italy. He's an Italian scholar. He lives in Italy, and he's Molisano. Published by Cosmo Iannone Editore, which is a Molisano publishing house, and that has dedicated a great deal of its editorial energy to the Molisani nel mondo. This is an example of what Silvana Mangione before called the cultura di ritorno. This is. Also an example, serves as a model for what I think other Italian publishing houses and what Italian institutions of higher learning, i.e. universities, can and should do. And that is to study, I'm not going to say to study at a greater length because basically it's not part of the curriculum, to study for the first time, or as we would say in Italian, una volta per tutte, Italian emigration, or the Italian diaspora. It is through that, I think, that we can better understand, from this perspective, what has and continues to go on in Italy, and what they can better understand from their perspective, what has and continues to go on here, so that we don't have a repeat of some of the writings of a Prezzolini or a Mario Soldati or a Cecchi or even an Italo Calvino, as some people may not know, did not always speak nicely of Italian Americans. So this is our sort of major, this is the overall sort of task that we need to always keep in mind, that this dialogue is ever developing, and it is ever so necessary, and it is ever developing. And it is through an event like this, through the goodwill and the largesse of those in Italy, of our friends here who have come, through the support of the region, of the province, and so on, that makes this type of conversation possible.
Gentlemen of the jury, I have finished. After this comes your verdict. I do not ask you to acquit us. It is not in my power to do so, after my attorney has so nobly and ably pleaded for me. I say, though, that there are two ways open. If we are responsible, we are responsible in full. If what the district attorney has said about us is true, that we ought to pay the extreme penalty, for if it is true, it was a premeditated crime. If what he said is true, it means that we went to Lawrence specifically for that purpose, and that for years and years we had been studying and maturing our thoughts along that line. Then we expect from you a verdict of guilty. But we do not expect you to suit your conscience, and at the same time to give an helping hand on the other side, simply to go and reason and say, well, something has happened there, and somebody is responsible. Let us balance the scales and do half and half. No, gentlemen, we are young. I'm 29 years old, not quite yet. I will be so 2 months from now. I have a woman that loves me and that loves me and that I love. I have a mother and father that are waiting for me. I have an ideal that is dearer to me than can be expressed or understood. A life is so many allurements, and it is so nice and so bright and so wonderful that I feel the passion of living in my heart, and I do want to live. I don't want to pose to you as a hero. I do want to pose as a martyr. No, life is dearer to me than it is probably to a good many others. But I say that there is something greater and nobler and holier and grander, something I could never come to terms with. And it is my conscience. And it is my loyalty to my class and to my comrades who have come here in this room, and to the working class of the world, who have contributed with a splendid hand, penny by penny, to my defense, and who have all over the world seen that no injustice and no wrong will dance to me. Therefore, I say, weigh both sides and then judge. And if it be, gentlemen of the jury, that your judgment shall be such that this gate will be opened and that we shall pass out of it and go back into the sunlit world. Then let me assure you what you are doing. Let me tell you that the first strike that breaks again in this Commonwealth or any other place in America where the work and intelligence and the help of Joseph J. Yetor and Arturo Giovannitti will be needed and necessary, that we shall go again, regardless of any fear and or any threats. We shall return again to our humble efforts, obscure, unknown, misunderstood. Soldiers of this mighty army of the working class of the world, which out of the darkness and the shadows of the past, it's striving toward this destined goal, that is the emancipation of humankind, that is the establishment of love and brotherhood and justice for every man and every woman in this earth. On the other hand, if your verdict shall be the contrary, and if it be that we who are so worthless as to deserve neither the infamy nor the glory of the gallows, and if it be that these hearts of ours must be stilled by the same dead share and by the same current of fire that has destroyed the life of the wife martyred and the parricide, then I say, gentlemen of the jury, that tomorrow we shall pass into a great judgment. That tomorrow we shall go from your presence into a presence where history shall give its last word to us. Whichever way you judge, gentlemen of the jury, I thank you.